Good morning.
Good morning.
We're going to, the scripture, the lesson this morning will be from Revelation 22, 17 and 21. Revelation 22, 17 through 21. Yes, that's the last verses of the Bible. Revelation 22, 17 through 21. And if you'll allow me, I want to read from the King James Version. Me too. I like it too. As I'm doing this, I'm hearing the pages to get there. Just give you a minute. Revelation 22, that's the last chapter of the Bible, the 17th verse. And the Spirit and the Bride, I take it that's the Holy Spirit, say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whoever will, let him take the water of life freely. For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. He which testifies of these things saith, surely I come quickly. Even so, amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. God bless the reading of his word, and let's bow before I preach. Father, I ask that you would bless the reading of your word. Please add to it in my preaching. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I picked the King James on purpose because I'm trying to practice it a little better. I didn't do so well on that. It is a little bit out of my sync when I read it. But I do love the King James, and I did grow up with it. When we went to school, the NIV was very popular. And so I kind of grew up more on that in my learning. But I find myself coming back to the King James. I really find it to be very, can I say this, more adequate in some ways, even though it is ancient in the way that it speaks. It's a little outdated. Y'all, the Bible opens with a promise. You ever thought about this? It opens with a promise in Genesis.
Yes.
The promise of a coming Savior. The promise of a coming deliverer who would rescue people from their sins. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed, and he shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise him on the heel. Genesis 3:15. The Bible begins with a promise. As we said, the promise of a Savior, a deliverer, a rescuer of men and women by destroying the enemy, Satan himself. The Bible then begins with the promise of a Savior, and that is how it ends. Verse 20 of Revelation 22 says, yes, I am coming quickly. Only this is a promise of his second coming in judgment. Whereas Genesis is a promise of his first coming in humiliation, in poverty, to vulnerability, and in weakness, he is returning in power and strength and glory and majesty.
Amen.
And in judgment.
Amen.
He came unto his own, and his own knew him not. The Bible says, when he returns, every tongue will confess.
That's right.
Jesus was born in Bethlehem, fulfilling Genesis 3:15. And he will certainly come again. Amen. However, people may scoff, and they do, and reject him, and they have and do. However long it may be, and sometimes it seems like it's been a long time, this is the immutable word of the eternal living God, surely I come. Yep. And you can believe it. The book of Revelation, without getting into much detail, because it can be complicated, and I admit to my inadequacy in maybe not exegeting as much of it as I can. That's a work in progress for me.
A big work.
And for many. I'm not alone in that. We'll just say that it is certainly, of course, concerning the prophecy of the second coming of Jesus. We can say that with certainty. It is the apocalypse. It is the unveiling glory of the Son of God. It is the final statement on the unveiling glory of the Son of God when he returns, and every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is Lord. The book of Revelation is all about his second coming, and it offers an invitation in light of that. In light of that second coming, that is. In general, that's the context of this. And as Revelation reaches its end and the certainty of Christ's return is clear, the Holy Spirit in this chapter is calling for a response. Now, I want to break it down a little bit. This is more academic, but I'll try to make it interesting. I want to break it down and come right to these verses so it'll set a better context. It's what I always try to do, from larger to smaller, so we have an understanding when we're right there, when our minds are right there, and then I'm hoping it has more of an impact that way, is why I do it that way. Verses 6 through 12, we didn't read those, but if you look at those verses, if you don't mind looking at them, it might be called a response from Christians. And I'm just going to briefly state these things. They are asking, the Spirit is asking for immediate obedience, worship, proclamation, and service in those verses. The second end of that 13 and beyond, it might be the response of non-believers, and that's what I want to focus on today. Non-believers. It is God's final plea, so to speak, for those who are still rejecting him. And there are many rejecting the gospel and Jesus. So that makes this scripture timeless and relevant for today. Maybe not for this room, but for today, today's world. The invitation is verse 17. We read that, "And the Spirit and the bride say, come." That is the Holy Spirit and the church, because the church is supposed to be together with Christ. We are owned by him. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst say, come. And whoever will may come. That is for all people.
Amen.
Even though they might not know they're thirsty. So we break it down into those two categories. Now we get down to a little more nitty-gritty. I've looked at this and found three reasons why God is compelling non-believers to come to him. The incentives, you might say, that he is giving. Verses 12 and 13. I'm trying to do something a little different. I've got a little marks, and I'm going to try to use my Bible a little bit more. It might be a little more sloppy, but I'm going to try it a little more this morning. Verses 12 and 13 in that same chapter, and 16, really speak of the person of Christ being an incentive to non-believers to come. And you might say, well, Tim, what are you talking about? That's the first thing. I just want to briefly hit the first two points, and then I want to really talk lastly about the last point. The first point is that. The second point is there is an incentive to come to Jesus, Because of the exclusivity of heaven, you'll be left out if you don't respond to the invitation. That's the second reason. And the third reason, which we really want to preach about, which these verses speak of, are talking about because of the truthfulness of the scripture. Those are the three reasons that I see in this text that Jesus and the Spirit and the bride are pressing upon people who do not believe and who are not obeying to come to him. And we'll just hit them briefly. Number one, if the person of Jesus. Why is this significant? I'll just briefly say this. It is because of who he is. Jesus is imploring in verses 12 and 13 and 16. It is not the church who is inviting. It is not me, the preacher, is who inviting. It is Jesus himself who is doing the inviting in this chapter. Amen. We are only sending invitations on his behalf. Amen. The eternal one, Jesus, the beginning and the end, Jesus. Do you see how important this is? The person of Jesus is compelling non-believers to come, the Alpha and Omega, the root of David, speaking of his humanity. And we talked about the root of David. You remember my sermon on the genealogy? The bright and morning star, which speaks of his heavenliness. That's it. I'd like to talk more about that, but that's not where we're going this morning. The transcendent one, Jesus, the Son of the living Lord. Jesus is offering the invitation. Jesus is the source and end of all things. And it is that one who is offering the invitation. Amen. To turn Jesus down is to spurn the eternal being. Isn't it?
Amen.
He is the eternal being of the universe. And turning him down comes at an immense cost. Well, you may turn me down if I have a wedding, and I have a wedding, and you may not come to my wedding, and I might personally make a cost, but to turn down Jesus' invitation will come at an ultimate cost to your soul. So it is Jesus himself who is making the invitation, and I just want to briefly touch on that. That's all I'll say about that. I want to say that, and this is not a popular thing for me to say, and I want you to say I don't take pleasure in what I'm saying, but I am compelled to say what the Bible says. I have to preach it. If I don't, I'm responsible for not saying the truth. Heaven is going to be exclusively only for those who are washed in the blood.
Amen.
Look at verses 14 and 15. And I don't want to dwell on that a lot because it's not the emphasis of the sermon this morning. And I really want to focus on the last part, but we read in Psalms 51:7, purify me with hyssop and I shall be clean. Doesn't this refer to the cross? Wash me and I'll be whiter than snow. That's beautiful. Isaiah 1:18. Come now and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are as scarlet, they will be white as snow. Though they are like crimson red, they will be like wool. Only those who are washed in the blood. Peter says it like this. You were not redeemed with perishable things like silver and gold, but with the precious blood of a lamb, unblemished and spotless, the blood of Christ. Yeah. Hebrews 9:14. And I can't really think of a better way to prove a point than by just saying what the Bible says clearly. Oh, you can speak from history, you can speak from philosophy, you can speak from the text, and we are, from the words of the Greek, and really get detailed. But just say it like the Bible says, and I think it'll prove the point to us who all believe, because we approach the Bible honestly, with a pure heart, not adding to it, and not take it away from it. We want to know it, which is the characteristic of a true Christian. Hebrews 9:14, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Isn't that beautiful? And I end with Ephesus, Ephesians 1:7. In Christ, we have the redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses. And we are forgiven. And it is a wonderful thing. And it is a beautiful thing to me in my life, because I certainly need it. And we all need it, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And we all are here in the blood of Jesus. And we rejoice together, and we say with the Spirit, and we say together as a church, come. Come if you want to be washed in blood. And that's kind of, you think about, how can you become clean if you're washed in blood? Well, it's not really talking about that, is it? It's talking of the spiritual truth. So, we come to the final scripture that I want to really focus on and really preach on. Jesus and the church is compelling non-believers to come to him because of who is offering the invitation. Jesus is becoming, because it is, you will be left out if you don't come, and it will be a terrible thing. And lastly, because scripture is true. Because of the truth of scripture. Verses 6 and verses 10 refer to this. Do not seal up the words of the prophecy of this book. The words are true. That's verse 10. The words are true. They must be proclaimed and obeyed. They must not be altered. Don't add to them. Don't take away. They are true. Proclaim them. Sinners need to respond because of the truthfulness of these words. That's not very popular. What I'm saying is true, and you better believe it, and you better listen. Well, those Christians aren't very tolerant, are they? They think they know everything, don't they? They think they have the exclusive truth, don't they? No, we don't. But God certainly does. And these are his words. Sinners need to respond because of that. Maybe we need to do a little more training in that regard about how powerful and what the Bible is. The words of the living and eternal God are important. And you must, let me say this, Christian, you must respond. Have you ever thought about that? You must. Ignoring them is a response. And everybody's ignoring them. We must obey them or suffer the results of disobedience. God save our souls. And what is the result of disobedience or apathy? Well, it is throughout Scripture, isn't it? It's clear. Those who don't heed the words of the Bible will not partake in the tree of life, it says. And what will it be like without God? Terrible. If you live your life without God in this life, you will live it without God in the next. These are the true words that are spoken in Revelation. Amen. It is what it says. This should not shock or irritate any of us. It just is. We should not be shocked that it's exclusive, because it is. But the invitation is to all, isn't it? To all. It's really not exclusive. It's only exclusive if we let it be. We must proclaim it. People, even now, are dying and going to hell. And we'll continue to do so. Every day, if they don't accept God's word, and it's kind of like a silent second death going on. It's just happening. Nobody cares. Nobody seems to think about it. And it's a silent second death. They're dying physically, and their soul dies too. That's a terrible thought. I don't even really like to say it. But it's true. Keep in mind, this prophecy is a warning. It's a warning, and it is a prophecy. Don't add to it. Don't take away from it. It is the truth of what God says. And you know, this is not new. I want to read you other portions in the Bible that say the same thing. The same thing. And I'll take a portion from each of the sections of the Bible. We're going to look at the Torah. I'll look at the writings, and I'll look at the prophets. We'll look at all those. Just Deuteronomy. We'll take it from the Torah, the Pentateuch. You shall not add to the word which I am commanding you, nor take away from it, that you may keep the commandments of your Lord God, which I commanded you. Thousands of years before, it's not new. God's words are immutable and unchangeable. Don't take away, don't add. So this is really an old method. It's an old method of speaking. A way of protecting and preserving things. A way to guard the writing. Don't touch it, is what God says. Take it exactly as God says it. Y'all, doesn't that fit in perfectly with what the Christian church does? What we try to do. We are not. I'm not saying we are perfect. No, I'm not saying that. But don't we say the Bible and the Bible alone? Not what men say, but what God says, what the Bible says. It's a noble effort. It is very noble on our part, and it's true. Deuteronomy 12:32 says, what I command you, you shall be careful to do. You shall not add nor take away from it. In other words, it's not old. I mean, it is old. This is nothing new. Proverbs, the writings. Do not add to his words, or he will reprove you, and you will be proved a liar.
Well.
A lot of preachers adding to the word today, aren't they? Not very careful about how they exegete and do exposition and say what the Bible says. A lot of ignorance. And God's not going to excuse that. I'm not condemning anybody. I pray for his soul. The text doesn't say that, but I think maybe he's going to be harsh on those who add to it or take away. Well, wait a minute. Yes, he does say that. What I'm saying is, in my heart and in our heart, we don't wish harm things to happen because we repeat what the Bible says, and it is tough. It is God who is. Don't play with God and his words. Jeremiah, the prophet, says this. Said the Lord, stand in the court of the Lord's house, and speak to all the cities of Judah who have come into worship in the Lord's house. All the words I have commanded you, you speak to them. Do not omit a word. Exclamation. In the Pentateuch, the prophets, in the wisdom literature, the law, the prophets, and the writings, Jesus referred to it all the time. And in Revelation, the final book, the same warning, an ancient warning. And it is still relevant in modern times and today. So we can safely extend the warning to all of Scripture, if it is God's word. And we can safely extend this principle to every book in the Bible, for they are all God's word. It is, though it was planned this way, and it was, a sweeping warning to all who would mess with the Bible. And boy, the liberals have tried to mess with the Bible, haven't they?
Amen.
Look at the Jefferson Bible, a great founding father. He took every single miracle out of it because they didn't believe in that kind of thing. I hope Jefferson is okay now. I hope he is. God is taking care of it. If we believe that the Bible is the word of God, and we do, and we believe God is very systematic and ordered, and he is, from Genesis to Revelation, it's really almost too much for me to us to study and hold it in our mind. It is certainly from God. It is a lot. Enough to keep the academician busy for life, and enough to make the man of modest education marvel, isn't it? It's for everybody.
Amen.
The Word of God is for everybody.
Amen.
And it's really marvelous that it's like that, isn't it? Everybody. So brothers and sisters, nothing can improve the Word of God. Come to it and study hard and learn it. Live it, obey it, and worship Him. Brothers and sisters, let's say together in Psalms 119, "Oh, how I love thy law," and let us just meditate on it day and night. The religious fanatic overinterpreted and improperly interpreted. How many books are written on Revelation? A lot of them, aren't there? They are a dime a dozen, let me tell you. And the liberals take away from it by discounting its truthfulness, its validity, and the very nature of Scripture. Woe to the liberals. This is a perfect plea, as I said. Although we may not understand it all, God does. We may not be able to explain it all. We may not be able to interpret it with exact precision every time, and we cannot. We may not always touch the depths of it. We may not be able to understand all of its mysteries, and we cannot. But I love it, and we love it.
Amen.
And we would never tamper with it on purpose. And this is the mark of a true believer, isn't it? Pure of heart. Longing for the pure milk. Are you a true believer?
Praise the Lord.
Yes. And Jesus even said this. So Jesus is saying to those Jews who believed in Him, and there were Jews that believed in Jesus, "If you continue in My word, then you are truly disciples of Mine." Are you a disciple of Jesus? Do you love His Bible? John 14:23, Jesus answered and said to him, "If anyone loves Me, he will keep My word. And My Father will love him, and He will come to him and make our abode with him. He who does not love Me does not keep My words." Not word, words. The Word of God is everything to us. As babes, we desire the pure milk of the Word that we may grow. True Christians hate the salts of the Word of God. True Christians love the Word of God, for it is our strength, isn't it? True Christians keep the Word, for it is our righteousness. True Christians read the Word, for it renews our mind. Love it, read it, keep it, obey it. Sinner, become like-minded in regards to the Word. And that is the plea of Revelation to the sinner. And we're coming to a close, Brother Glenn. Christian, rejoice and prepare. Sinner, repent, for He is coming quickly and surely. And it is certain that He's coming. The last words of Jesus, "Yes, I am coming quickly." And the one whom Jesus loves, John, affirms this and says, "Amen. Come, Lord Jesus." The last thing the Bible says after all this is, "Grace is available to all." Do you notice those words? Those last words. "The grace of the Lord Jesus be with all." Isn't that beautiful? It really is. Amen, it says. Grace is yours. Grace is mine. Are you ready? Yes, so let us live with joy.
Hallelujah.
Joy because of grace. So let us live with expectancy. Expectancy. He is coming soon. I'm not saying that He's coming right now, but in God's eye, a day is like 1,000 years and 1,000 years a day. God is certainly coming, and He's coming soon.
Amen.
Let's live like it. Let us live by the Bible. For its law is telling us of his grace, which saves our souls. He is coming again, and we will live with him forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Praise God.